Is everybody ready? Okay, here we go.
Yes.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. And that song is, guess what? I don't know the name of it. I literally have known that song since I'm a kid. I never played it with the band, but I could always play it on my horn. And for the life of me, I asked some of my musician friends here in Milwaukee. Nobody can come up with the name. I'm putting it out to you, my audience. Please, if anybody knows the name of it, give me a call. I'm going to keep on trying. And whoever, the first one that calls in or writes in with the name, we'll give you a special mention the next show that we do. So there we go. It's a beautiful song. And, you know, just check it out. See if you know it. And if you do, you know, the contact Ron on my website, The Real Ron Miscavige, that's how to do it. Okay, so now, where do you go to hear stuff like this? Where do you go on TV or the internet to hear an interview and the guy doing the interview comes on, plays a 100-year-old horn, and many of the songs are between 50 and 100 years old? I'll tell you where you go. You go right here. The only place you'll hear this and is Life After Scientology, and I'm your host, Ron Miscavige. Okay, so that's our standard intro. I kind of like it. I hope you guys out there like it too. Anyway, we want to announce a special announcement for Adesra Rogers, which became a patron. And for some reason, I guess her name slipped between the cracks. And Desra, I'm awfully sorry about it, but I'm giving you an acknowledgement right now. Desra Rogers for $5 a patron. Thank you very much, Desra. Okay, and for you out there who, I should say for yous out there who don't know what this is, you can go to my website, therealronmiscavige.com, and become a patron, which is a way to support this show and contribute to it and, you know, go from being a listener or an audience into an actual participant, because you are doing something about keeping the ongoingness of the show. So there you go. So much for that. And we have our last week guest back today. And those of you who haven't seen it, I wouldn't say don't look at this one. Watch this show and then go 1 week prior, last week, and listen to what this gentleman had to say, because this is Geoff Levin, and he's the guy that wrote the Dianetics theme. We play it on that show. You know, the one that goes, starts off like that, which was watched by I don't know how many millions of people to promote the book, Dianetics, the Modern Science of Mental Health. Geoff is a musician, and he has a very interesting take on musicians and artists who go into Scientology. And listen to what he has to say about this, because I'll tell you, I never thought about it. But the concept of going as a loner and as a musician, and he goes into this last week, as a musician, you do become a little bit of a loner, because one of the things you got to do is practice. If you want to get gigs or become good. And this requires hours of you being by yourself and just running through those scales and the various things you have to do. There's no shortcut to it. The greatest musicians that I have ever known all told me the same thing too, that it takes just practice. But we're not going to go into that as much as what happens to a lot of musicians and artists who come into Scientology. So I don't want to get into it any further than that intro because I don't want to steal his thunder. So please welcome back for your education and enlightenment, Geoff Levin. Geoff, good morning, buddy.
Morning, Ron. And I think that was a good intro. I think that something that I observed when I was still involved with Scientology always disturbed me. I couldn't go deeply into it because that would mean I would have to start questioning the actual structure and foundations of Scientology. But I did observe these things, and I actually found a handwritten document that I had sent in 1980, where I saw certain things happening, and I saw that music artists and other types of talent were becoming a little bit disaffected with Scientology.
Wow.
This was 1980. This was something, it was an undercurrent. I don't think anybody else articulated it or spoke out. I felt it was an issue enough that I wrote a pretty long program of how Scientology could handle this so that they got people back on board.
Geoff, let me interrupt you just for 1 second. Could you send me a copy of that, please?
Well, it's all handwritten, so it'd be, but I will send it to you.
Yeah, just photocopy it and send it.
Yeah, okay.
Through the airwaves, because I'll tell you, I'd like to have that for my own education. And I got to say this, that took some courage to do, even though in those days. But if you did it today, I will tell you, you would have probably been declared an SP.
Well, I'm already declared an SP, so
hey, oh, yeah.
We're good.
Well, you could become a double SP. You know, that's
yeah, that's true. I think you could. They probably should have medals for that. Where, you know, I know certain people like Karen and Mike Rinder. They would have probably. They keep getting ribbons.
Oh yeah, they would.
For being a double, triple, and quadruple SP.
Yeah,
I just have one ribbon right now. I'm just starting. I'm a baby.
The insanity of it is wonderful. I got to tell you, man.
I know. But anyway,
yeah. Go on.
One of the things that I saw, which is very subtle and very demeaning to music artists in particular, and this was one of the things that I forgot about, is how much we resented the fact that we were asked to perform at events. We were asked to do things to give our facilities, like if you had a recording studio, or you might be an engineer and you helped with the sound for an event.
Right.
You know, and this is all before Gold was really taken off. At Golden Era Productions, where all of this became a Sea Org job. So yeah. That you had people handling the sound of events, the music at the events. But before that, there was none of that, so we all had to volunteer.
Yeah.
We were expected to volunteer, and there was no exchange. There was nothing that you got back for it. Maybe you got a commendation, which would be a written piece of paper that said that you were commended for what you did.
Yeah.
Now you might have put in with practicing and the event and the pre-event and stuff like that. You might have put in 20 hours of your time.
Maybe a lot more, because for an event, it's a lot of prep work. Well, you were maybe.
Yeah, no, I did. I did something like 800 events.
Wow.
For Scientology, because I saw this as necessary to help out, and it was how I could help. At the same time, there wasn't much awareness of, it was more the attitude of, oh, you should do this.
Yeah.
Almost like you owed it. This is what you can do. If you don't have big bucks, And of course, big bucks superseded everything. If you had big bucks, then you were, didn't make any difference whether you did anything else.
Yeah.
If you were a big, and being a big donor in those days meant you paid for a lot of services.
Right.
Because at that time, donations were frowned upon.
Yeah.
A little. Nowadays, donations are the big thing that makes you, gives you status in Scientology. Is not that you're getting anything, that your spiritual freedom is being enhanced by the courses and the therapy that you get. You're just giving them money.
Yeah.
And then they're telling you, hey, look, this is what your money buys. And they make a slick video. And then you think that that's helping the world and changing the world. You donated $100,000. You're now a patron. And look what we, look what your money has done. Anyway, back to the music thing. This was 1980, and we were all feeling that this was not right. Now, they never rectified that, really.
Right.
I think of all 800 performances that I did, I think I was actually paid for maybe two.
Wow. Okay.
And that was it. And everything else, it was just pro bono. And sometime you weren't even acknowledged.
No, and Geoff, it was never volunteer. It was that you were expected to do that. Of course, they called it volunteer, but as you said a minute ago, if you didn't do it, you were no good.
So this goes back, let's go back to the issue of, I feel that when you join Scientology as an artist, but especially a music artist, you've now changed your passion. I guess that's the way you could say it. Every great music artist I know has to do it. It's their passion. It's their therapy. It's their connection, you could say, to a higher power. You know, if you, whatever you want to call it, I call it universal consciousness. That connection, and I noticed this a lot when I would watch the Grammys, how an artist, and especially Black music artists, would come out and they'd thank God.
Yeah.
And I would, at the time, I kind of scoffed as a Scientologist. You know, I was like, oh yeah, okay, we've heard that a million times. Well, I think that the connection to that, whatever it is for you, is very powerful. And in Scientology, honestly, your music and your passion for your music is secondary to clearing the planet. And to me, that right there, you've now invalidated that individual and whatever it was that prompted him to want to get into music. Whatever the reason, there was a passion there. There was a need there. And the need, and now that need is now, and that passion is now directed towards something else, not your individual feelings.
You know, I'm going to tell you something, Geoff. If you were to stop talking right now and we ended the video, that statement that you just made makes total sense to me. That makes total sense. And just as an aside, I also call, as people would call God, the universal consciousness. But it is true that that's what you really want to do. I mean, even as a kid, I started playing in beer gardens when I was 13 years old. I loved it. I'd play 5 hours and get $2 an hour. I mean, mind you, in those days in the 40s, you could buy a pair of jeans at Penny's for a buck and a half.
Right.
That's what I really wanted to do. And getting into Scientology, that thrust toward a greater attainment for yourself has changed to making the primary purpose for your livelihood and your energies to clear the planet. Immediately, it's alloyed.
Well, and I'll give you an example that is personal, and then I'll give you an example of somebody, of an artist who's still in Scientology, a music artist who I respect tremendously.
Okay.
and how I feel he's been in for a long time, but I wanted to play a piece that he wrote very early on when he was just, thinking about being in Scientology, or he was in Scientology, but he wasn't immersed in it to a point where that was his greater focus.
Yeah.
But my band, People, the example, we had a hit record in 1968. I was the leader of the group. I was driving it, driving to have that success. I had a goal. It was to have a hit record.
Right.
And that was the passion that I had to play, to perform, to reach a lot of people. It was huge. And we got the hit record, or we were just on the verge of the record hitting the charts.
Yeah.
And we joined Scientology. And within 3 months, the group was breaking up, or we were, what happened is we kicked out one of our lead singers and destroyed the group. And I was one of the people responsible for making a horrific career change or career decision. You kick out one of the lead singers who's on your hit record and you can't replace him because nobody sounds like that guy. That's a really stupid decision. And we made that because Scientology and the philosophy of Scientology was going to supersede everything, all my common sense. And it basically wiped out that band. So we never had a follow-up hit. The band was never the same after we removed the lead singer.
Hmm.
And I might as well bring this point up now because I think it's another point where you're indoctrinated almost the moment you decide you might want to do Scientology.
Right.
And that's the subject of disconnection. And we learned disconnection in the concept of the suppressive person or the person who was causing you problems in your life. And we learned it right away. And then immediately we became experts. And we targeted one of our lead singers as that type of person, an antisocial personality. So therefore, he either had to get into Scientology or we had to remove him. So we took the easy route rather than just deal with it and not push him to do anything he didn't want to do and just work together. We removed him because we had targeted him as that kind of a person. The bigger view of it, in my opinion, is think about it. Music artists have to be free to communicate to anyone, any place, any time that they want. That's part of their gig. They want to connect with more people. I think you talk to any music artist and you say, well, would you like to, if you had a choice, would you like to sit home and play in your living room and not have anybody hear you and get really good, but you're the only one who hears yourself? Or would you like to get out in front of people, show them what you've done, communicate with them, connect with them, and do your art with as many people as you can? I think we know that.
Yeah, of course.
Which the answer is going to be. And I think that's inherent in the music artist. He's a communicator.
Yeah.
And if you now start making that communicator fearful of who he can connect to and who he can't connect to, you've just squashed his whole intention.
Yeah.
And so that's one of the first things that you learn now. And I'm amazed there are certain friends of mine who are ex-friends of mine, people who I've known for decades, who are Scientologists, and they won't communicate with me anymore. And I've lost a musical ally, in my opinion. But in every case, these people that I know, in my opinion, they peaked a while back, and I don't see any growth. Because I think to have growth, you have to have really freedom.
Yeah.
And it's really, it's ironic that Scientology talks about total freedom. And the first thing they teach you almost is that you're not free to communicate with everyone.
You know, you're right. That is, and they talk that well, it's called the bridge to total freedom.
Yeah.
A complete lie, a complete, absolute 180 degree truth, they're stating. It's the bridge to total entrapment. You're taught who you can communicate with, what you can say, what you can do, because if you say the wrong thing, you're going to come in and be interrogated, you know, by their ethics officer, like the personal Gestapo. And no way you could be a musician fully in your desire to express what you have to offer, man, and live by those rules. Geoff, you're making a lot of sense.
Well, we can get back to the. Let me play this this song. This not the whole thing, but this is one of my favorite Chick Corea songs.
Okay.
And this was written. Geez, I don't know. It's from. It's a Return to Forever tune, but it's brilliant, and it's now a standard in my. My opinion, and you'll recognize it.
Yeah.
Pretty long song. We're just going to cut it's a long intro and then we get into the body of the song.
Okay.
I just want to hear the hook. I forgot how long it is.
Here comes the hook, right?
I hope so. Yep. Forgot that's Ayerto and Flora Purim. Playing with from the album Light as a Feather. And I don't think I think they were briefly in Scientology.
Yeah.
Great musicians. Anyway, that song.
It's called Spain, by the way.
Spain. It blew me away. That was a very early creation of Chicks. And my feeling, and I'm not going to talk about. Because I've seen Chick perform and he's still, you know, forget it. He's amazing.
Yeah.
But the thing that I noticed in general with music artists who join Scientology, that they get to a point where they just, and this is my opinion, they stop growing. And it's reflected in their music.
And I want to say one thing now. Chick was that way before he got in Scientology. He didn't get that way to play that tune after after he got in. You know that.
No, yeah, no. He was on a path towards stardom as a writer and pianist.
Right. But I just wanted to make the point. That was how Chick was before he got in.
Oh yeah. Well, I'd say that I can cite other music artists the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, they were on a path towards stardom.
Yeah.
And when I say stardom, I don't really mean that, on brilliance. And they were amazing, and they worked very hard to do that. And there was no other focus. There wasn't, well, it's great that you spend, you know, 5 hours practicing. However, you have to put your 3 hours of study in every day. So, okay, now you got 8 hours. You're not going to have any life between Scientology and trying to be, what's going to win?
Yeah.
Well, Scientology, in my opinion, has won every time if you stay in. So, I'm going to mention a list of, these are people that I was friends with or actually performed with who have died, and I feel that they never fully reached their potential, or they just quit music. And these were all talented people, and they're gone now.
Yeah.
And I think it's sad. I'm going to talk about two people that I was very close to, but I'll just go down the list.
Okay,
and people will probably remember many of these talented artists, and we've lost them. And some of them left Scientology, and some of them were still in till they died. A lot of them, actually. Dick Glass, the Eloquent Elephant. I used to tour with him, and I was on his first album. Wonderful singer-songwriter and entertainer. Tamara Wilcox, who was an actress, singer, and she had a group called Interplay.
Yeah,
Interplay used to perform musical numbers, improvised. You give them a subject, and they do a whole musical.
I will tell you something. I remember the piano player, Johnny?
Johnny Jacobson.
Johnny Jacobson. An unbelievable piano player. The audience would call out...
A style.
A famous composer.
Earl Garner.
And then, Earl Garner. And he would play the song he was playing right in the middle of it without even stopping. And he'd immediately go into that style, which you would expect to hear from like Bach, you know, da da.
Yeah, or you could do Bach. I heard him do Chick Corea. I heard him do. He could play. Yeah, he was amazing, and I remember he died very young. He was part of that group, and I mean, he had some health issues and stuff, and he had terrible diet, and he was a genius.
Yeah,
what can I tell you? And I was privileged to have him come over and record a little bit and show me what he did. Sweet guy.
Yeah.
And he's on the list. I got him here. And then Jimmy Spheris, who I recorded and performed with, who was a brilliant poet, singer, songwriter, huge. He had a huge following in the Midwest, and he had a terrible time in Scientology. He never buckled under. And the story about Jimmy that I think was horrible is Jimmy was bisexual, and then his preference kind of shifted over, and he was gay at a time when it was really tough being gay, even tougher being gay in Scientology. You can't be gay in Scientology.
No, they say otherwise, but that is not true at all. You just...
Yeah. Yeah, no, you can't continue if you're gay.
Yeah, a gay person is considered covertly hostile.
Well, they're considered almost to fall into the antisocial personality category.
Yeah.
Anyway, I was buying that at the time, and this is the story, that Jimmy was going to do his fifth album. He was going to be produced by... Chick and Stanley. They were going to work with him.
Wow.
On his fifth album. And the gay thing he was kind of keeping under, you know, under the table, and then it finally came out. And then in a one fell swoop, he got disconnected from.
Wow.
Chick and Stanley just said, no, you know, if you're not going to handle this, then we can't work with you.
Okay. But for our audience, you're referring to Stanley Clark, the bassist.
Stanley Clark, yeah. So anyway, that was a drag. And unfortunately, I was party to that too. And at the time, I was making a transition. I didn't want to go on the road. So this was a justification for me to pull away from Jimmy. And Jimmy and I were really close. I was the guitarist on four of his albums.
Wow.
And these were on, the first album was on CBS. And the last three were on Epic Records. It's a big deal.
Yeah.
Big deal for me. Anyway, Jimmy, we lost Jimmy. He lost a lot of his friends. And a side note, Jimmy was very supportive of music artists, and Diana Hubbard had some talent as a keyboardist.
Yeah.
I don't know if you knew that.
I absolutely knew it.
And Jimmy was the producer on her first album. He was so encouraging to her. And she, I don't think she ever severed her connection to Jimmy.
She wouldn't. I know Diana personally, and she's a very nice lady. I got to tell you, man.
Yeah, I wish she was. What I know is that she's kind of trapped.
Yeah.
Up at
yep.
And yeah, she is a very nice lady, and I knew her because of who I was in Scientology, and then Jimmy was very close with her. Anyway, someone who just died recently, I'd say in the last year, Tom Fair, who's a singer-songwriter. And then someone that you and I know very well, is very sad, and it's a sad story in itself, and I got him, I'm one of the people who got Charlie Rush into Scientology.
Yeah, Charlie was a dear friend of mine, I got to tell you, man.
Sweetest guy, and he went from playing on the ship with the Apollo Stars and working directly with Hubbard to getting busted at some point or not being useful anymore as a drummer. And he was in the kitchen at the Big Blue Complex.
Yeah.
And now he's like bussing dishes at 60 years old.
Yeah. No. So,
anyway, let's keep going. Amanda Ambrose, who donated, she should have been, should have had a great retirement if she'd just been paid a standard fee for every performance she did for Scientology. She would have been able to, if she got older, to retire. I don't think they ever paid her.
No, I bet they never did. As a matter of fact, I played several gigs with Amanda, and she would have a bunch of musicians backstage, and she would say, come on out, boys. She would be at the piano, and the musicians would come out, like Rick Shaw did a gig that time, and Jimmy, the sax player from, used to be at CC, I can't think of his last name.
Oh, Jim Cowger.
Jim Cowger, yeah. And I came out, and some others. We wouldn't even know what she was going to play. Mm. We didn't even know the key, and she's playing. And everybody was hip enough that we could sound out what it was, and the band sounded like an all-star band. Complete and utter create. Take that against some of the shows I would do where every word I had to say was scripted, where every piece of music you had to play the exact dots, pushed down into a little ball, where it's coming out on the stage, don't know what the hell you're going to play in the key, and it sounds incredible. Just making your point, because once you start pushing a person off his basic purpose, and when we went on stage with her, all our purposes were kindled.
Yeah, I got to say, because I performed with Amanda.
Yeah.
And we did a little bit of kind of touring. What a gracious lady.
Yeah, I know.
And she would tear the house down.
Yeah.
And another point I want to make is that I feel is so exploitive is that people are sucked into Scientology, and all these old timers who we see were responsible for attracting the attention of people who were not necessarily sold on Scientology or didn't know about it. And they would somehow get taken to a performance of one of these artists. And they would, in essence, reflect so positively on the organization that people would join it.
Hey, look at Isaac Hayes. I don't know how many gigs we did with him. The only thing Scientology ever paid him was his expenses, like airfare and accommodations and things like that. As far as you know, he never got paid a dime. Isaac Hayes.
I was going to bring that story up, but let's keep. I want to get this through this list.
Okay.
I could go on stories of people that I know and how very directly they were controlled in it. Basically, to me, brought them down.
Yeah.
And Isaac is one of those people. That story is horrible.
Okay, you want to save it for a little later. Let's get with it.
Yeah. Right. Anyway, let me just go through these people and people that I know. You know, Sherwood Ball.
Now wait, you got to tell a little bit about that because he just finished Superpower.
Yes.
Isn't that good? Okay, tell the story if you know exactly what.
Well, I've known Sherwood for a long, long time before he joined Scientology. I knew Sherwood, and he sang for me before he was a Scientologist. I have recordings. He did a movie. He did a song on the movie that I scored, and we needed songs, and he sang it, and he was great. And then he sang on another song, very gracious in singing on a song for one of my albums. But anyway, Sherwood was kind of out of Scientology. He was living in Hawaii, just doing his thing. I think he was doing well. And he has a daughter, and he was raising his daughter, and he was married. And then he came, I think he and his wife had a split up, and then he came back to the mainland, that being LA.
Yeah.
From Hawaii. And he met, he was starting to get interested in Scientology again, and he met a gal, I'm not going to mention her name, and she was a big FSM. FSM is a field staff member, somebody who either recovers you and brings you back into Scientology if you were in, or brings new people in. So he came back in, he seemed to be doing well, and then he got involved in the relationship with this woman. And then I saw him change. All of a sudden, I saw it because it happened to me, but Sherwood, it happened much later. He became a zealot. And Sherwood Ball, just so people understand, he is one of the sons of Ernie Ball. And Ernie Ball was one of the biggest string manufacturers of guitar strings in the world. And you talk to any musician, even non-guitar players, and they know who Ernie Ball is.
Yeah.
And so Sherwood had access to inheritance and stuff. And so he became a big donor, and he started doing events to get other people to donate. And then he went to Florida, where the Mecca of Scientology is, and he did a thing called Superpower, which is a very high-level, expensive series of drills and things that is supposed to give you superpower. That's why it's called Superpower.
Right.
And he did that, and he did a purification rundown again. He had done it before, which is supposed to be a detox program. He did those things, then he went to the Freewinds ship, and on the ship, and this is endemic of Scientology. Many Scientologists don't take care of their health. They're a little bit fearful of medical people because Hubbard didn't like them. And so anything that might involve medication, in my opinion, we've been, as a Scientologist, I was educated that it was scary, that it could cause major problems to me.
Right.
So he's on the ship. He's just done the Purif, which probably weakened him because he's like 62 years old or something. And that's, there's some very toxic things in their detox program that are dangerous for certain people. Anyway, he's on the ship. He has a stroke. And rather than, this isn't verified, but this is what I was told. There was no doctor on the ship. This is a cruise ship with no doctor. They have a medical officer, but they didn't have a doctor. So he's on the ship. He has a stroke. They don't really know what to do, and he's not really being treated. They don't rush him to a hospital. What they do is, rather than, because that could be bad publicity for that ship, that they had somebody with no doctor on the ship. And so instead of taking him to a hospital, and I think they were in Bermuda where they weren't that well known. I'm not sure which port, but they were in one of those ports in that area. They put him on a plane and send him to Miami.
Wow.
And now he's like really, really ill. And he dies in a coma in Miami.
The short story is he did superpower, the Purif, went to the ship, had a stroke, and died.
Yes, that's the other part of it is that they call it a shore story,
yeah,
which is the official story of what happened.
Mm-hmm.
They said the reason they didn't take him to the hospital is because the hospitals were very substandard and dangerous on this at this particular port. So at the time I did the research to go, how many hospitals could they have taken him to, and how good were the hospitals? And it turned out these hospitals were top-notch hospitals in this port.
Wow.
And the story I was given was they were terrible, very dangerous to even go to those hospitals. So we sent him to Miami. So I was lied to.
Yeah.
About it to cover up this whole thing. So anyway, that's a side story. It's not, it's pretty normal when somebody dies in Scientology, especially if they're well known and they've spent a lot of time going up the bridge to total freedom and spent a lot of time and money on it, and then they die, sometimes young, it's kind of covered up.
Yeah.
Quietly push it aside, because the end result of Scientology is you have complete control of not only your body, but the surroundings, your environment. You are a powerful being who can control all of this.
Well,
so that doesn't quite mesh up. With,
no, I would call that a sure story. Okay.
Yeah. So anyway,
that's sure. An acceptable truth. In other words, a lie.
Yeah.
Anyway, we should get her because we have a lot of names.
Yeah, I know. I mean, the time goes by. Let me quickly go through the list, because I do have a story that I want to tell that I think is representative of the real attitude of people in Scientology. I'll just rush through these and give Pat Marishek, who is a singer, songwriter, drummer, OT8, part of a group called Pat and Pat. And Johnny Pierce, songwriter, producer, who played with Juice Newton and had a song on Kathy Mattea's album that I co-wrote. And it was a hit album, and we wrote a song, and it was on her album. Joanna Pierce, Johnny's wife, who is a singer, songwriter. Jamie Font, who we all know, excellent bassist. An educator, Gloria Rausch, who worked with John Novello.
Yeah, great singer.
Married, great singer, married to John Novello. And Jeannie Diva, who's another OT8 who died recently, she's a singer, voice teacher. Nicky Hopkins, who we knew, the wonderful piano player, played with the Stones. And then Isaac Hayes, that's a whole other story, which we may not have time to get into. And Gordy Gale, Sonny Bono. We always forget Sonny, he was a singer.
Yeah.
And Johnny Jacobson, who we'd mentioned, the pianist for Interplay. Rick Patterson, I don't know if you know him. He was a very successful commercial composer.
I didn't know him, but I knew of him. Well, he was in the San Diego area, is that right?
Yeah, San Diego. Excellent writer and arranger. Yeah. He was writing for CBS, for NBC. He was writing all these music packages for their news and for their IDs and stuff. Susan Todd Hunter, I don't know if you remember her. She was an opera singer. Very sad. She died very young.
I do remember her. Yeah.
Very beautiful pretty, girl, really pretty, yeah. Blonde, and she had a great voice. Don Bosca, pianist and arranger. And then a big guy that is sad, Mario Fenninger. Another person who did probably 1,000, 1,500, maybe 2,000 performances for Scientology. And he never paid, I don't think.
Yeah.
And a wonderful classical pianist. And then John Batson, really talented songwriter, and Jerry Hall, who was a engineer and did a lot of big music artists. And then Marty Butwinick, bass player and music teacher, who he performed with a lot of bands and did a lot of performances for Scientology. Lamont Johnson, an early pianist, very talented jazz guy. He scored the first Scientology movie.
Wow.
Which was done, and Stephen Boyd, the actor, was in that movie.
I remember that. Yeah.
And so was my close friend and associate and creator, Jeffrey Lewis, was in that movie.
Yeah.
And then Karen Black, at the end of her career, she was singing and she had a live show where she sang, told stories. She could sing. And then there's one other one that I don't know personally, Eduardo Paloma. He is an actor singer and he died very young. He was a Mexican in Scientology.
I knew him personally and his wife. And I took the Golden Air Musicians up to Celebrity Center where they had a funeral ceremony and I played for that ceremony.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So this is sad as a loss to us. And a lot of these people, I think, died before they needed to. And I wanted to mention the story because we do have to wrap it up, of my close friend, Johnny Pierce. And Johnny was a bass player, and Jimmy Spheeris got Johnny Pierce into Scientology. Johnny was a big fan of Jimmy's and a very talented musician, bass player, but he also played guitar and he wrote beautiful songs. And Johnny died young. He died of throat cancer. He was still a Scientologist. Johnny had to disconnect from his son, Jason, because Jason had joined the Sea Org at Celebrity Center in LA. And Jason was young and ill-equipped to deal with that kind of stress or that kind of environment that you have to deal with in the Sea Org. So he was kicked out of Celebrity Center, and then he became homeless, from what I heard.
Wow.
This is Johnny's son. And Johnny was told he had to disconnect from him. So Johnny did, because he was a good Scientologist. Now, I'd say about 10 years later, I may be getting, Johnny contracted throat cancer. He lived in Nashville. And Jason came back to help Johnny, even though Johnny had disconnected from him. So now Jason is helping Johnny, who's dying. And Jason is living in my friend Johnny's house in Nashville.
Right.
And Scientology is giving him assists. These are things to help people who are ill to get better. So Johnny's still connected to Scientology. And because Jason was declared a suppressive, Johnny was not supposed to, he was not supposed to be there. So what I was just told by Jason's sister is that some Scientologists, probably an ethics officer, the people, the police of Scientology, told Jason that he was killing his father.
Wonderful. And Jason, unbelievable.
I know, it's unbelievable. And so you know what Johnny did? He kicked the Scientologists out of his house and he said, never come back. So at the end of Johnny's life, he realized just how crazy this concept of disconnection was.
Wow.
And the whole concept that there are evil people that we have to disconnect from.
It's just...
Anyway, I that story just was beyond belief to me.
It is beyond belief.
You're going to tell the son of his dying father. And today, oh, by the way, happy Father's Day. I forgot to say happy Father's Day to you.
Thank you very much, man. I appreciate that. And just, God, do I miss my kids. Just,
yeah, well, I do too. I mean, we could.
Yeah.
Kind of wrap, both my children have disconnected from me.
Yeah, well, both my daughters and my grandchildren and their children, and of course, David.
Yeah.
And I do have a son that I communicate with all the time.
Which, yeah, well, I'm so happy that Ronnie's out.
Yeah, and of course, Jenna and Dallas and Winnie and Archie, my great-grandchildren. Mm-hmm. I still love the story with little... It's moments like these that I miss being able to share with them. I remember Winnie, when I went out there to visit him a while ago, my wife and myself, I wanted to give her some money, but I like to make a game of things. So I had a $20 bill, and this kid is about 5 years old, little beautiful girl. And I said, now, I'm going to ask you a question. And if you give me the right answer to this question, this money is yours. And this little lovable kid said, don't make it too hard. I love it. And of course,
we could do a whole show on disconnection.
Yeah. And here's another thing as an example. I remember saying to her, look at, I had told the story before, but I'm going to tell it again. What the hell? Okay. I said, look, I'm actually your great grandfather. Now you already have two grandfathers. So instead of calling me grandpa, why don't you call me Jadek? Because that's how you say grandfather in Polish, but it'll be a little different. So it's Jadek. So Winnie, what should you call me? And she stopped for a moment. She said, Bubbles. I said, no, Winnie, Jadek, what should you call me? Bubbles. So that's my official name for her, Bubbles. Anyway, by any chance any of them are watching, I love all of you. And somehow, one of these days, you got to get back with me. I don't want to live my life and, you know, having missed you as my friends. They're my children, but they're really my friends. We've had wonderful times together. Let's not let it end this way.
I think that what I would say is I'm hopeful. I feel like what you're doing in bringing out another side that has been basically pushed down and whitewashed is going to get to those people inside. You can't lie. If you tell a lie, you have to keep telling more lies to keep that lie alive.
That's true.
If you tell the truth, you never have to worry about your future.
Well, I think you're right, Geoff.
And so what you do in speaking out and your show is really valuable. And I'm speaking out for the same reason, because I experienced so much. I saw so much. I couldn't understand it, its true impact, when I was inside of Scientology. When I got outside of it, I realized this was going on all the time, and I accepted it.
Yeah.
And now I look at it and go, no. Yeah, I experienced it. I can talk with authority about it.
Yeah, nobody, you can.
I mean, any Scientologist, I'd be happy to talk to them in terms of questioning the veracity of what I have to say, because I was there.
Geoff, I got to tell you, this has been a pleasure talking to you, and it's wonderful having you on. Do you feel you've told your whole story? I don't want to pull the plug on this, and I still have some more to say.
No, but I did. Part of my story, we're doing a documentary with some very good filmmakers called Brothers Broken, and it's about the experience of my brother and my disconnection.
Wow.
And it goes through us growing up in the Bay Area, performing and being hanging out with people like Jerry Garcia. I think we mentioned this last time. And
yeah,
but it goes all the way up to the present, how I reconnected with my brother, what a joy that was after 28 years to actually have a brother again.
God.
I think I should come back, because we didn't even talk about the transition that I had to go through in order to get out of Scientology.
I'd love to have you back. The door is always open. You're absolutely welcome on my program as a guest, Geoff. This has been greater than I thought it was going to be. How do you like that? Not that I thought it was going to be bad, but there's some wonderful insight you have.
Well, I think the whole thing I love, and I realize my new kind of, you could say, change the world passion.
Yeah.
Is to support music artists, to encourage them, to give them shortcuts, to mentor. That's what I feel like. That's how I feel we can change the world. Music, there's no question. Music is the unifying language of this planet.
Yep, you're right, buddy.
And it can diffuse and change people and change situations and start movements that are good movements, that are positive movements. And the fact that you and I, we're like brothers. We have that in common.
That is true, my friend. Okay, my producer's trying to get in touch with me. Go ahead.
Hey, okay, Ron, we got two super chats. One for $3 from Carrie Ann. She says, Happy Father's Day, Ron. And $2 from Chris Clenotes says, Happy Father's Day, Mr. Miscavige. So.
I'm choking up. I gotta pull the plug on the program.
Okay.
All right.
Good talking to you, and enjoyed it.
Geoff, thank you very much. And all of you out there, if you feel that you'd like to contribute to this, you can go on to my website, therealronmiscavige.com. Become a patron. I'd appreciate it very much. So all of you out there who have lost their family or friends to disconnection, I wish you the best of luck. God bless you. And to the fathers who can't speak to their kids, Happy Father's Day. See you next time. Bye-bye.